بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله الحمد لله وكفى، والصلاة والسلام على السيد الحبيب المصطفى وعلى آله وأصحابه نجوم الهدى قادة التقى. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد كما صليت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آل سيدنا محمد كما باركت على سيدنا إبراهيم وعلى آل سيدنا إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم اغفر لنا وارحمنا ومشايخنا ووفقنا لما تحب وترضى من القول والعمل، وجنبنا الفواحش والمعاصي والخطايا والزلل. اللهم اغفرنا ولا تؤثر علينا، اللهم اعطنا ولا تحرمنا، اللهم اكرمنا ولا تهنا، اللهم ارضنا عنك وارض عنا، اللهم اصلح لنا شأننا كله، لا اله الا انت. اما بعد، قال: فاخبرني عن الاحسان. قال: ان تعبد الله كانك تراه، فان لم تكن تراه فانه يراك. We are going through the hadith of Sayyiduna Jibreel alayhi salatu was salam. When Sayyiduna Jibreel alayhi salam came and asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi salam a few questions. First question was Akhbirni anil Islam. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi salam mentioned the five pillars of Islam. Second question was Fakhbirni anil Iman. Tell me what is Iman. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned أن تؤمن بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله واليوم الآخر وتؤمن بالقدر خيره وشره. And the third question he asked was فأخبرني عن الإحسان. We've covered the first two in the previous lessons. Now we're into the third one. He said, tell me about إحسان. What is إحسان? Now he asked this question because in Quran Majeed the word Ihsan is repeated in many places. For example, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says وَأَحْسِنُوا إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says إِنَّ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ إِنَّا لَا نُضِيعُ أَجْرَ مَنْ أَحْسَنَ عَمَلًا. Allah says, وَلَا مَنْ أَسْلَمَ وَجْهَهُ لِلَّهِ وَهُوَ مُحْسِنٌ فَلَهُ أَجْرُهُ عِنْدَ رَبِّهِ وَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لِلَّذِينَ أَحْسَنُوا الْحُسْنَى وَزِيَادَةِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَيْسَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ جُنَاحٌ فِيمَا طَعِمُوا إذا ما اتقوا وآمنوا وعملوا الصالحات ثم اتقوا وآمنوا ثم اتقوا وأحسنوا إن الله يحب المحسنين. Allah says ومن يسلم وجهه إلى الله وهو محسن فله أجره عند ربه. So this إحسان أحسنوا محسنين. Allah repeats this word in many places. Ihsan, Ihsan. What is the meaning of this Ihsan? And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam explained. Allama Sharafuddin al-Tibi rahmatullahi alayhi writes in the commentary of Mishkatul Masabih that the word Ihsan literally has one of two meanings. Number one, it either means al-in'amu ala al-ghayr, that you do some favor to someone. For example, you say Ahsantu ila Zaydin, Ahsantu ila Ahmad, I did some favor to him. You did Ihsan on him. We also see in our Urdu language as well, Uspar Ihsan kiya. So you do favor to someone is called Ihsan. And number two, Ahsana Zaydun means he did something beautiful. أَحْسَنَ زَيْدٌ and he did something حَسِين and beautiful and good. Like for example, you were going outside and this young boy who's just entered in the masjid, you saw him doing something good, he removed some brick or some screw or something which would tear up the tire from the road, or some banana skin or dirt, he removed it, put it in the dustbin, and you saw him and you say, Ahsanta ya walad, you did good, dear son, mashallah, good akhlaq, you are a good boy, you did something good. So ahsana also means to do something good. So in literally, in lughawi ma'ana, it's used in both meanings. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Inna naraka min al muhsineen, يعني المجيدين المتقنين في تعبير الرؤيا. So سيدنا جبريل عليه السلام asked, ما هذا الإحسان? The word إحسان, إحسان which comes in Quran, what does this إحسان mean? And Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم replied that إحسان means you do عبادت and worship in the most beautiful manner, in such a way that you are realizing that Allah is before my very eyes, as though I can see Allah. You visualize Allah. Because if you don't see Him, He sees you. So you have that in your mind that I am watching Allah, Allah is watching me. Then you will do your ibadat in the most beautiful manner. Your khushu', your khudu', your istihdar, your attention, your focus will be upon your salah. Your mind will not wander around here and there. You won't go into waswasas and whisperings of shaitan and other evil thoughts, because you know you are standing before Allah. So this is ihsan, an ta'bud Allah ka'annaka tarah, fa in lam takun tarahu fa innahu yaraka. You worship Allah as though you are seeing Him, because if you don't see Him, He definitely sees you. So as soon as you say Allahu Akbar, you throw the whole world behind your back and you bring Allah in your heart and mind, and you are totally focused on your salah. You recite Quran, you are focused and reciting the word of Allah. And you recite properly with tajweed, with khushu', khudu', istihdar. You don't rush into it. When you go into ruku', you bow down, you know that I'm bowing down in front of my Rabb. You say, Subhan Rabbi al-Azim, Subhan Rabbi al-Azim, Subhan Rabbi al-Azim, with tawajjuh and attention. And then when you go in sajda, you realize I'm putting my forehead on the ground in front of my Rabb. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is closest to a person when he is in sajda. The hadith says, أَقْرَبُ مَا يَكُونُ الْعَبْدُ مِنْ رَبِّهِ إِذَا يَكُونُ سَاجِدًا فَأَكْثِرُوا فِيهِ مِنَ الدُّعَاءِ فَقَمِنٌ أَنْ يُسْتَجَابَ لَكُمْ. The closest a person can be to his Rabb is when he is in sujood. So make dua as much as you can in sujood, because it is highly likely that your dua will be accepted. So you realize that Allah is there, I'm focusing, my attention is towards Allah, and I am putting my forehead in front of Allah. In this manner you do your ibadah. And not just salah, other ibadat as well. So you fast throughout the day, you realize that Allah is watching me, I mustn't do anything wrong. Even if I'm alone, nobody is watching me, I'm thirsty, real nice chilled drink is in front of me, but I shouldn't drink it because Allah is watching me. I am fasting, I have to fast properly. And not just from eating, drinking and sexual intercourse. You fast from everything, any makruh as well, any mashkook things as well. Don't do anything makruh. Don't do anything like, for example, ghibat, backbiting. Its severity increases in fasting. It's haram anyway, but when you're fasting, it's more severe to backbite, more haram. So you avoid it. So everything, lying, backbiting, cheating,
gaze, looking at things you shouldn't be looking at, nudity. Avoid all that in the fasting because you know Allah is watching you. Similarly, zakah. When you give sadaqah, when you give zakah, you give it while realizing that Allah is watching me, this sadaqah which I am giving, Allah is looking at me while I am giving it. So I am giving it for Allah, not to show off to someone that such and such a person is sakhi. I don't want to show to people that I am sakhi. I want to show Allah. And I am giving this money to the poor person for the sake of Allah. When you go for hajj, then while you are performing your hajj, you have at the back of your mind that Allah is watching you. As soon as you put your ihram on and you say labbaik Allahumma labbaik labbaik la sharika laka labbaik innal hamda wal ni'mata laka wal mulk la sharika lak, then you visualize Allah is watching me, Allah is listening to my labbaik. Sayyiduna Imam Zainul Abideen Ali ibn Husayn ibn Ali ibn Abi Talib karramallahu wajhahu was a very very ascetic zahid person. And when he came for Hajj and he arrived at Dhul Hulayfa, he put the ihram on, performed two rakat salah, and then he was about to say labbaik Allahumma labbaik, but he couldn't say it, he fell unconscious, he fainted. People are saying labbaik, he's trying to say it, but it's not coming out of his lips. And he said it 2-3 times and he kept on fainting. Someone asked him, why does this happen to you? And he says, because I feel scared. What if Allah calls out to me, la labbaik? Your labbaik is not accepted. What will happen to me if Allah calls out to me like that, in that manner? Because I am not a good person, I am a sinful person. Allah could desert me, reject my labbaik. That is why I can't say labbaik, I am here, I am here. Finally, somehow, they calmed him down. And he managed to say labbaik Allahumma labbaik and proceed. This shows his istihbar and his tawajjuh and his attention towards what he was trying to say. This morning I got this very nice condition of Sayyiduna Imam Zainul Abideen, which I want to read out to you. Since we have talked about him, then let me read this to you. أصمعي, a great poet says, بينما أنا أطوف بالبيت ذات ليلة إذ رأيت شابا متعلقا بأستار الكعبة وهو يقول, while I was doing tawaf of Baytullah at night, I saw a young man who was holding on to the clothes and the covering cloth and the covering of Ka'batullah Sharif, and he was crying and reciting this poetry. يا من يجيب دعاء المضطر في الظلم يا كاشف الضر والبلوى مع السقم قد نام وفدك حول البيت وانتبهوا وأنت يا حي يا قيوم لم تنمي أدعوك ربي حزينا هائما قلقا فارحم بكائي بحق البيت والحرم إن كان جودك لا يرجوه ذو سفه فمن يجود على العاصين بالكرم. He was saying this poetry, O Allah, you are the one who responds to the call of the needy one in the darknesses of the night. O the one who removes hardships and problems even when a person is extremely ill and in need. Those around your house have gone to sleep and some are awake. However, you, O Hayyu Qayyum, have not fallen asleep. I call upon you, my Rabb, while I am sad, while I am worried, and while I am in anxiety. Please have mercy upon my yearning and crying by this beautiful house of yours and by this haram and vicinity around over here. If it was thus that nobody can hope for your reward except a wise and understanding person, and the stupid people should be deprived of your generosity, then O my Rabb, who will be generous to the sinners like myself? I need your generosity and your karam and your mercy. He said these couplets ثم بكى بكاء شديدا. And then he cried profusely. وأنشد يقول. And then he began to say, ألا أيها المقصود في كل حاجتي شكوت إليك الضر فارحم شكايتي. ألا يا رجائي أنت تكشف قربتي فهب لي ذنوبي كلها واقض حاجتي. أتيت بأعمال قباح رديئة وما في الورى عبد جناك جنايتي. أتحرقني بالنار يا غاية المنى فأين رجائي ثم أين مخافتي. Oh, the one who is maqsood and needed in every hajat and need, I relate to you my problem, so please have mercy upon this relating of mine and this problem of mine. You are my only hope. Only you can remove my problems. Please forgive me my sins and please fulfill my need. Of course, I have arrived at your blessed house with deeds which are ugly and which are ridiculous, which are not worthy of putting in your courtyard. Throughout the whole makhluk and creation, there is not a single person who has committed so many sins as my sins. Will you then burn me in the fire while you are my last hope? Where will my hope go and where will my fear go? So he said these couplets. Asma'i says, فَدَنَوْتُ مِنْهُ. I went close to him and I noticed, فَإِذَنْ هُوَ زَيْنُ الْعَابِدِينَ عَلِيُّ بْنُ الْحُسَيْنِ بْنِ عَلِيِّ بْنَ أَبِي طَالِبِ رضي الله عنه وجمعين. He was زَيْنُ الْعَابِدِينَ عَلِيُّ بْنُ الْحُسَيْنِ. So I said, يَا سَيِّدِي مَا هَذَا الْبُكَى وَالْجَزَعِ وَأَنْتَ مِنْ أَهِلِ بَيْتِ النُّبُوَّةِ وَمَعْدِنِ الرِّسَالَةِ. My master, what is this crying and what is this yearning and screaming, crying, shriek, when you are from the family of the prophethood and you are from the roots of the risalat and messengership? Do you not read the word of Allah in Quran? إِنَّمَا يُرِيدُ اللَّهُ لِيُذْهِبَ عَنْكُمُ الرِّجِسَ أَهْلَ الْبَيْتِ وَيُطَهِّرَكُمْ تَطْهِيرًا. In which the virtue of Ahl al-Bayt and family members is mentioned, Allah says, O family members of the Prophet, Allah intends to remove all filth from you and to cleanse you with utmost cleanliness. So Imam Zainul Abidin said, Hayhat, hayhat, ya Asma'i, إِنَّ اللَّهَ خَلَقَ الْجَنَّةَ لِمَنْ أَطَاعَهُ وَلَوْ كَانَ عَبْدًا حَبَشِيًّا وَخَلَقَ النَّارَ لِمَنْ عَصَاهُ وَلَوْ كَانَ حُرًّا قُرَشِيًّا. أَلَيْسَ اللَّهُ يَقُولُ فَإِذَا نُفِخَ فِي الصُّورِ فَلَا أَنْسَابَ بَيْنَهُمْ يَوْمَئِذٍ وَلَا يَتَسَاءَلُونَ فَمَنْ ثَقُلَتْ مَوَازِينُهُ فَأُولَئِكَ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ وَمَنْ خَفَّتْ مَوَازِينُهُ فَأُولَئِكَ الَّذِينَ خَسِرُوا أَنْفُسَهُمْ فِي جَهَنَّمَ خَالِدُونَ. He said, O Asma'i, listen carefully. Allah has created Jannah for those who obey Him, and even though he might be a colored slave, and He has created Jahannam for the one who disobeys Him, even though he is a freed Qurashi. Do you not read what Allah says? When the trumpet is blown, there will be no lineage connections among them on that day, and they will not be able to ask one another for help. Thereafter, whosoever's scales are weighty, then they will be the successful, and whosoever's scales are light, then they are the ones who have destroyed themselves in the fire of Jahannam, where they will remain. Radiallahu anhu wa arda'ahu. This was the fear and the khawf of our Salafi Saliheen. Such a pious personality who used to perform 300 rakats nafal salah every day, and who used to take care of 100 family members throughout the city of Madinah Munawwara. Such generous and such worshipping person, and he is so scared of Allah, he couldn't say labbaik and faint. And here he is crying in front of the house of Allah. This is because of their istihdar, their khushu', their khudur, their realizing that Allah's watchful eyes are over me. This is ihsan. This is creating husn and beauty in your worship. This is how your beauty, your ibadat and worship becomes beautiful. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, if you want to make your ibadat and worship look good and beautiful, then this is how you will have to worship Allah throughout your daily life. Whatever you do, whether you sit down to recite Quran, or whether you sit down to do some dhikr of Allah, or you sit down to recite some tasbihat, whatever you do, you worship Allah, you do it with the utmost best possible manner, utmost perfection, complete manner, with concentration. This is ihsan. This is what Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentioned in this hadith. Hafiz ibn Rajab al-Hanbali rahmatullahi alayhi writes over here that أن تعبد الله كأنك تراه. It means that a person should reach that level and that stage where he can have istihdar of his qurb and proximity and closeness to his Rabb. And this will in effect generate in him khashiyat, khawf, haybat and ta'zeem, fear, awe, inspiration, respect. Because when you know, you realize that Allah is watching me, you will be respectful to Allah. You will have fear of Allah. You will make sure that your clothes are packed, clean, pure, your body is clean, your heart is clean, your mind is clean, you are standing in front of Allah with clear inside and clear outside. So purification of ruh and purification of body, then you will have that. And this is why in the hadith of Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used the word, أَن تَخْشَ اللَّهَ كَأَنَّكَ تَرَى, that you fear Allah as though you are looking at Him. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave this nasiha to many other sahabas as well. Ibrahim al-Hujri narrates from Abu al-Ahwas, from Abu Zar radiallahu anhu, who said, أوصاني خليلي صلى الله عليه وسلم أن أخشى الله كأني أراه فإن لم أكن أراه فإنه يراني. My Khalil, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, my close friend, my deep close friend, instructed me to fear Allah as though I am seeing Him. Because even if I don't see Him, He sees me. Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu says, أَخَذَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ بِبَعْضِ جَسَدِهِ فَقَالَ اُعْبُدِ اللَّهِ كَأَنَّكَ تَرَاهُ. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam got hold of my shoulder or part of my body, my hand, and he said, O Ibn Umar, worship Allah as though you are looking at Him. Nasai narrates from Zayd ibn Arqam radiallahu anhu that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Kun ka'annaka tara Allah, fa'in lam takun tarahu, fa'innahu yarak. Be as though you are looking at Allah. Because even though you don't see Allah, He sees you. Tabrani narrates from Anas radiallahu anhu that one person asked Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Rasulullah, hadithni bi hadithin waj'alhu mujazan. Give me some advice and keep it short. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam replied, Salli salata muwaddi'in. فَإِنَّكَ إِن كُنْتَ لَا تَرَاهُ فَإِنَّهُ يَرَاكَ. Pray the prayer of a person who is departing from this dunya, who is bidding farewell to this world, who knows this is my last salah, and after this salah, I'm not going to get the chance to perform another salah. This is my last salah. So he will be totally focused on that salah because he knows at this moment my ruh is going to come out. The enemy is going to kill me, chop my head off. And this is my last salah. So he will pray salah with real focus, concentration, because he knows as soon as my head is cut off, my ruh is going to fall in front of sajda, in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So every namaz, every salah you pray, think this is your last salah. That this is your last salah. After this, you're not going to pray again. So when you get that in your mind, that this is my last salah, you will be totally focused on your salah. And he said, فَإِنَّكَ إِن كُنْتَ لَا تَرَاهُ فَإِنَّهُ يَرَاكَ. Because even though you don't see him, he sees you. Another hadith narrated from Harithah radiallahu anhu, narrated in various ways by Imam Tabarani, Mursal and Muttasil. He narrates that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to Harithah, يَا حَارِثَةَ كَيْفَ أَصْبَحْتَ. How are you this morning? And he replied, أَصْبَحْتُ مُؤْمِنًا حَقَّ. Alhamdulillah, this morning I am in such a state that I am a proper, perfect believer. So Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أُنظُرْ مَا تَقُولُ فَإِنَّ لِكُلِّ قَوْلٍ حَقِيقَةً. Watch what you are saying, because every sentence has a reality. So when you are saying, I am a perfect believer, what is the reality of your sentence? What do you mean that I am today, this morning, I am a perfect believer? And he replied, Ya Rasulullah, عَزَفَتْ نَفْسِي عَنِ الدُّنْيَا فَأَسْهَرْتُ لَيْلِي وَأَضْمَأْتُ نَهَارِي وَكَأَنِّي أَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ عَرْشِ رَبِّي بَارِزًا وَكَأَنِّي أَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِ الْجَنَّةِ فِي الْجَنَّةِ كَيْفَ يَتَزَاوَرُونَ فِيهَا وَكَأَنِّي أَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِ النَّارِ كَيْفَ يَتَعَاوَرُونَ فِيهَا. Ya Rasulullah, my heart has detached itself from this dunya. I have no concern for this dunya. I have detached myself, disconnected myself from this dunya and attached myself to the akhirah. Now I stay awake at night, I stay thirsty in the day, meaning I perform tahajjud at night and I fast during the day. And my condition is such that as though I can see the arsh of my Rabb open, clear before my eyes, I can see the arsh of Allah. وَكَأَنِّي أَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ عَرْشِ رَبِّي بَارِزًا. And وَكَأَنِّي أَنْظُرُ, and as though I can see the people of Jannah in Jannah, how they are visiting one another. And as though I can see the people of Jahannam, how they are screaming and taunting and cursing one another. Their fights and quarrels, I can see them with my own eyes. When he said this, وَكَأَنِّي أَنْظُرُ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِ الْجَنَّةِ فِي الْجَنَّةِ كَيْفَ يَتَزَاوَرُونَ فِيهَا وَإِلَىٰ أَهْلِ النَّارِ فِي النَّارِ كَيْفَ يَتَعَاوَرُونَ فِيهَا. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَبْصَرْتَ فَلْسَمْ. You have gained basirat and insight of the heart. فَلْسَمْ, hold on to it. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, عَبْدٌ نَوَّرَ اللَّهُ الْإِيمَانَ فِي قَلْبِهِ. This person is such that Allah has put the noor of Iman in his heart. May Allah give us that noor of Iman as well. So all these riwayat, Abu Umama radiallahu anhu narrates, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave nasiha to a person, wassa rajulan, and he said, استحي من الله استحياءك من رجلين من صالحي عشيرتك لا يفارقانك. Be ashamed of Allah as you would be ashamed of two pious personalities in your society who would stay with you all the time and they would not separate from you. So if two ulama, sulaha, mashayikh, your elders were to stay with you 24 hours, how would you feel? How would you remain? Because you got that examiner over you all the time and you will be totally focused on whatever you do, you won't misbehave. So he said, similarly, استحي من الله. Allah is watching you, he's with you all the time. So be ashamed of Allah, have fear of Allah and haya of Allah. So keep that in your mind. And these are some of the nasiha of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with regards to being focused and paying attention to whatever you are doing, thinking and knowing that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is in front of us, He's watching us all the time. Like for example, there is this video camera over here recording this majlis. Then we know that someone is looking somewhere, we won't misbehave. This is why we have this video surveillance system in superstores, markets and on the roads, that people behave properly, people don't steal, people don't burgle. They realize that, oh, there's a camera in this shop and I'm being recorded, I'll be caught, so they won't commit burglary or steal anything. So similarly, we have to know that Allah's watchful eyes are over us all the time. Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu was once performing tawaf. And Urwa ibn Zubair started talking to him and asked him for his daughter's hand in marriage. Can I marry your daughter? And Abdullah ibn Umar did not reply. Later on, when Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu met Urwa ibn Zubair, he said, my friend, sorry, you might have felt bad when I did not reply to your question. And he said, yes, I did feel bad. So Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu said, kunna fi tawaf natakhayalu Allah bayna a'yunina. In the tawaf, my condition was such that Allah was in my khayal right before my eyes. So I didn't want to turn my attention away from Allah towards anything worldly. I wanted to be focused on my tawaf. That's why I did not reply. So the Sahaba's condition was like this. As soon as they stand in front of Allah, they realize Allah is watching me. Their ibadat was perfect, 100% perfect. And this was the condition of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And you know, this is why he said, وَجُعِلَتْ قُرَّةُ عَيْنِي فِي الصَّلَاةِ. The coolness of my eyes has been kept in salah. As soon as he would say, Allahu Akbar, he would feel real nice peace, tranquility, sukoon in his heart. He would forget all his tiredness of the body. He would have been running around throughout the day, giving da'wah, inviting here and there. But as soon as he says Allahu Akbar, his body's tiredness is all gone and he knows he's standing before Allah. He's focused on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is what is needed, this istihdar. This is why Allama Qastallani rahmatullah alayhi says, this wording of Allah, of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أن تعبد الله كأنك ترى, is from Jawami'ul Kalim. Because a person worships Allah in one of three conditions. First is that a person worships Allah while fulfilling all the apparent and external requirements of the Sharia, meaning wudu, ghusl, taharat, taharatul thawm, taharatul badan, taharatul makan, and qiraat, ruku', sujood, the apparent motions and movements. You do that, then your duty is fulfilled. Allah will not ask you whether you prayed or you did not pray. You prayed, so your duty is fulfilled. Whether your attention is there or not is another thing. But when you do this, the external conditions are met, your duty is fulfilled. This is the first and lowest condition of ibadat and worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Secondly, a person rises from this to the rank that أَنْ يَفْعَلَهَا وَقَدِ اسْتَغْرَقَ فِي بِحَارِ الْمُكَاشَفَةِ حَتَّى كَأَنَّهُ يَرَى اللَّهِ وَهَذَا مَقَامُ النَّبِيِّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ كَمَا قَالْ وَجُعِلَتْ قُرَّةُ عَيْنِي فِي الصَّلَاةِ لِحُصُولِ الْإِسْتِلْذَاذِ بِالطَّاعَةِ وَالرَّاحَةِ بِالْعِبَادَةِ وَانْسِلَادِ مَسَالِكِ الْإِلْتِفَاتِ إِلَى الْغَيْرِ باستيلاء أنوار الكشف عليه وهو ثمرة امتلاء زوايا القلب من المحبوب واشتغال السر به ونتيجة نسيان الأحوال من المعلوم واضمحلال الرسوم. That a person gets to the highest possible rank in which he has gone deep down into the oceans of visuality. and as though he is looking at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when he gets to that stage, then that is the stage of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. وَجُوِلَ الْقُدْرَةُ عَيْنِي بِالصَّلَاةِ. And Qassallani rahmatullahi alayhi writes that in that condition you feel lazzat and a special taste in your worship. Your ibadat becomes lazeez. You know, like we eat tasty food and we drink nice tasty drinks, then your ibadat becomes really tasty for you. You love your ibadat. And then you get rahat and sukoon in that ibadat. And your mind is not turned towards anything else. And the anwar of kashf have overcome you and they take over each and every corner of your heart. And the mahbub appears in your heart, your beloved Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And your heart is connected and mashgul and busy with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You forget all your surroundings that are around you. And this is that condition which is the top level of ibadat. And we should try and reach that condition. Sayyiduna Abdullah ibn Zubair radiallahu anhu, when he used to stand in ibadat, he would stand motionless for hours. And istighraq, kayfiyat of istighraq. To the extent that once he was doing ibadat in the house and a snake fell from the roof of the house and there was a baby and the lady started screaming and somehow they rescued the baby, they killed the snake. Abdullah ibn Zubair radiallahu anhu didn't even feel anything. When everything happened and he finished his salah, people asked him, did you not notice what happened? He said, no, I don't know what happened. He said, this happened. Oh, I don't even know anything. My mind was towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Urwa ibn Zubair radiallahu anhu had some illness in his foot. And the doctor said that we have to cut your foot. So amputate it. So he said, okay. And the doctor said, we have to give you some alcohol to drink so that we can make you unconscious. And like anesthetic, in those days there wasn't this anesthetic, maybe some sort of alcohol to make him not feel the pain. He said, no, tawbah, astaghfirullah, it's haram. I'm not going to drink it. He said, well, then we have to chop your foot off, otherwise the sickness will go and eat up all your leg. So he said, okay, you can cut it off. How? He said, let me start salah. And when I start salah, I will be focused on my salah, you do your work. And he did so. He stood up in salah, and they operated on his foot, and he never felt anything. He just kept standing focused on his salah. His mind was towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the highest stage, the stage of the sulaha, mashayikh awliyaullah, following in the footsteps of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would be performing tahajjud, in the beginning he used to go for ibadat to Ghari Hira, the cave of Hira. Loneliness, seclusion, nobody there, himself only. But later on, after the hijrat, he's in Medina Munawwara. He doesn't need to go into any cave or anywhere. He's performing his ibadat over there. His beautiful wife Aisha radiallahu anha is sleeping in the same room and he's performing his salah. And there is no distraction in his salah. Even though Aisha is sleeping there, but Rasulullah's attention and focus with Allah is the same. This is why many times he would come after Isha and he would say, Ya Aisha, da'ini a'budu Rabbi Azza wa Jal. Oh Aisha, allow me to worship my Rabb Azza wa Jal. And she would say, who am I to stop you, Ya Rasulullah? And he would perform fresh wudu and he would start the salah. Aisha would fall asleep and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would be busy in his salah. So he would get sukoon and peace and tranquility and in that connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the second stage which he mentions. And then he said, if you can't get to that stage, then the third will be أَن يَفْعَلَهَا وَقَدْ غَلَبَ عَلَيْهِ أَنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى يَرَاهُ وَيُشَاهِدُهُ وَهَذَا هُوَ مَقَامُ الْمُرَاقَبَةِ. That a person does his ibadat in such a manner that he realizes that Allah is watching me. Above was that he is watching Allah, but now Allah is watching me. Because if it's hard for you to feel that I'm watching Allah, I'm seeing Allah, I'm looking at Allah, then feel that Allah is watching me, Allah is looking at me. This is the third stage. يراه أن الله يغلب عليه أن الله يراه ويشاهده وهذا هو مقام المراقبة. معناه أنك إن لم تعبده وأنت من أهل الرؤية المعنوية فاعبده وأنت بحيث يراك. وكل من المقامات الثلاث إحسان إلا أن الإحسان الذي هو شرط في صحة العبادة إنما هو الأول، لأن الإحسان بصفة الآخرين من صفة الخواص ويتعذر من كثيرين. So this is Ihsan. You worship Allah as though you are seeing Him, because if you don't see Him, He sees you. And how do you get to that maqam? You have to remember Allah, zikr of Allah, attach yourself to Allah, then you will be able to get to that maqam. May Allah give us tawfiq to worship Allah in the proper manner, and may Allah be pleased with us. Inshallah, we will move on further, not next week, because I'm going away next week out of town. So maybe the week after, inshallah. So the hadith is, we have come to this area of أخبرني عن الإحسان قال أن تعبد الله كأنك تراه فإن لم تكن تراه فإنه يراه. You worship Allah as though you are watching Him, you are seeing Him, you are looking at Him. Because if you don't see Him, then He definitely sees you. So you get to that maqam, then this is ihsan, and this is beautifying your ibadat and your worship. May Allah give us tawfiq to put into practice whatever we learn. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala sayyidina Muhammad wa alihi wa ashabihi ajma'in. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa nastaghfiru wa natubu ilayk. Allahumma lakal hamdu wa lakal shukru. اللهم لا نحصي ثناء عليك أنت كما أثنيت على نفسك. اللهم صل على سيدنا محمد النبي الأمي وعلى آله وأصحابه وسلم تسليما. اللهم انفعنا بما علمتنا وعلمنا ما ينفعنا وزدنا علما. اللهم ارزقنا خشيتك في الغيب والشهادة وكلمة الإخلاص في الرضا والغضب. اللهم طهر قلوبنا من النفاق وأعمالنا من الرياء وألسنتنا من الكذب، فإنك تعلم خائنة الأعين وما تخفي الصدور. يا أرحم الراحمين، يا أكرم الأكرمين، يا راحم المساكين، يا ناصر المستضعفين، يا حنان يا منان، يا بديع السماوات والأرض، يا ذا الجلال والإكرام. اللهم طهر قلوبنا من غيرك ونظر قلوبنا بأنوار معرفتك. اللهم ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم، وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. وصلي اللهم وسلم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين برحمتك.